window.
Good.
Put those locks down.
Mahanrai, you hear me? Young man, don't you even think about it. Now, both of you, drop those rocks now.
Promise you won't whop us.
Have I ever whopped you before?
Promise.
All right. I promise I won't lay a hand on you, even though you both deserve a good spanking.
We don't deserve a spanking, you do.
Why? What did I do?
You upset Mama and Aunt Reba and Aunt Evangeline, and now they're going to be suffocates in the parade today.
They're going to be what?
Suffocates. They're going to march like a bunch of suffocates.
Suffocates? Do you mean suffragettes?
Yeah, that. Me and Ethan don't want them to.
Nobody else's brother's one of those.
They're making banners and everything.
Daddy, tell them they just can't do it.
You're the patriarch. You hold the priesthood, and they're just women. They have to listen to you.
Everybody else's mother listens to their husbands.
The only reason they're doing it is because of you.
Did they tell you that?
No. Last night we couldn't sleep, so we snuck downstairs and listened outside the kitchen door to them talking.
Why couldn't you sleep? Did you miss your own bedroom?
No, Daddy. We like Aunt Evangeline's house. We got to sleep in your old bed.
Mama says we get to live there from now on. Are you going to live here, Papa?
It'll be kind of lonely.
Don't worry about that. Me and Ethan will take turns coming to visit you, and on Christmas and holidays, maybe Mama will let us spend the night.
You can have my old bedroom, Daddy.
Thank you.
But first, you have to stop Mama and Aunt Reba and Aunt Evangeline from marching the parade today.
What does Moroni have to say about all this?
Isn't he here?
No.
That's funny. Aunt Evangeline thought for sure he'd be here, fussing with you.
Well, your Aunt Evangeline was wrong. When he left here last evening, he was very angry. He didn't come home last night?
We haven't seen him since yesterday. Where are you going?
To call the police.
But you have to stop Mama and Aunt Reba.
Boys, you'd have more luck stopping them than I would.
Challenge.
Reba, is it true that Moroni didn't come home last night?
He isn't here with you?
No, I'm going to call the police.
Wait, we have to talk.
Not now. When Moroni left, he was more angry than I've ever seen him.
Now, Talmadge.
Reba, the tone of your voice.
So what if Moroni stayed out all night? He is a grown man, and this is Provo, Utah. What trouble could he possibly get into here, for heaven's sake?
Well, maybe he's not in Provo.
He's not about to leave here as long as Anita is here.
Maybe she's not. Maybe they ran off to be married by some money-grubbing minister.
I doubt that. Moroni doesn't share your enthusiasm for secret weddings.
So, I'm still the villain, am I?
Talmadge, I didn't come here to talk about you, but about me.
Don't cry, Mama.
Oh, look. You've gone and gotten yourself all upset and crying. Come over here and sit down.
I'd rather stand, thank you. Go inside the house and pick out a pair of pants and a shirt and a tie for the parade.
Mom, I've never matched my clothes before.
Then this will be your first time.
What if they don't match?
You're a big boy now. You know your colors. I trust you.
You look exhausted.
I've good reason.
You haven't been sleeping well?
No one in this family slept last night.
You haven't told Evangeline and Beulah anything yet, have you?
Not yet.
Are you going to move into the big house?
That depends on your reaction.
To what?
My pregnancy.
What?
Why don't you go call the police about Moroni, and then we'll discuss it.
And Moroni can take care of himself.
Look what I've done, gone and gotten you all upset. Come over here and we'll discuss it.
Are you sure?
I've been sure for 3 weeks now.
Have you told the others?
I wanted you to be the first to know. If Beulah suspects anything, she hasn't let on. Though why she shouldn't know with the way I've been stumbling around and fainting recently. She must think me such a light-headed little simp.
But after Joshua was born, the doctor said you could never have any more children.
Well, it seems that we have been visited with a little miracle. Of all times. I nearly bled to death with Jasher. Talmadge, I'm afraid. I'm afraid that my condition is no blessing at all, but a judgment, a punishment from God.
A punishment for what?
For breaking every oath and covenant I made when we married. I have broken them all in my heart. Sometimes I simply despise Beulah and her boys, and other times Evangeline because she is so strong. Beulah and I laugh and say terrible things about her, and the boys hear us and throw rocks at her house. That is no way for a mother to influence her child. And sometimes I wish a disease or an accident would strike this family so that there would be no one but me and you and Jasher. And sometimes I hate the principal. And I, please don't hate me for this. But I hate God for commanding it. Sometimes, Talmadge, I'm sorry. And last night I couldn't sleep because for the first time I almost hated you. I thought I was to be the last one in your life. Some of my aunts were so bitter because they couldn't be my father's first wife, but I never cared about that as long as I could be the last, and I was so sure. But now I find there's to be another, and you have never been in love with anyone. So last night I almost hated you, and for a moment I wish we'd never married, and I'm afraid that my pregnancy is a punishment for my wickedness.
Don't cry. There, there now.
I'm scared, Talmadge.
Heavenly Father wouldn't punish you in this way. Where do you women come up with such crazy notions?
But I have broken all my marriage covenants.
In our hearts, all of us have. God forbid we should be shut down for it. Heavenly Father understands.
He's a man. How can he understand a woman's feelings?
It's a mystery to me. Maybe that's why he's God. You're a good wife and mother, Reba.
Then why do you want to marry someone else?
It's not because you're deficient in any way.
But I must be if you need someone else.
I don't know what to say. Maybe when you're older, you'll...
Talmadge, don't do that.
What?
Condescend. Whenever I press a point, you treat me as if I were a child.
Forgive me, Reba. You're not a child. I know that.
You're still going to marry this lady from St. George?
If it's God's will.
Well, when God tells you what he wants you to do, you come to me and I'll tell you what I'm going to do.
I'll tell you what you're not going to do.
I'm not your child. I won't obey you.
Then can I tell you what I wish you wouldn't do? I wish you wouldn't move in with Evangeline.
Well, I didn't marry her.
I wish you'd stay here.
With you.
I'll be here.
For a quarter of the time, if God approves your plans.
It would be a good time, that quarter. Reba, I'll try to make it up to you. I'll do my best to be a better father to Jasher and this baby, and a better husband to you. Please stay.
Beulah won't like it if I do.
Don't worry. Leave Beulah to me.
You're talking as if you're my father again.
Old habits are hard to break.
Try your best.
Now I think you better go inside and make sure our little boy is wearing clothes that match.
Anything, I really do.
Isn't that a touching sight? I've imagined the two of you sharing a tender moment such as this many times, but never did I envision so sweet a little picture.
Well, if it isn't the household brigade.
Indeed, coming for armaments. Materials for more signs and banners were left in Beulah's kitchen.
What do you hope to accomplish with this marching about?
Oh, Sir Rebus told you of our plan. How thoughtful of you, sister.
Ether and Mahanrai told me. And if you walked here from State Street carrying those signs, everyone at Provo knows about it by
well,
now.
Let's pray not. Without the element of surprise, our appearance in the parade would be shamefully anticlimactic. Oh, well, you two go along with whatever it was you were doing.
What were you doing, Reba?
Why, Beulah, whatever is going on here is between Talmadge and his wife.
Aren't I his wife?
Only when it's your turn. Now you see, sister, the principle is rather like a game of hide and seek. When it's Reba's turn to be it, then you hide and keep out of her sight. Now when you're it, you cover your eyes and she hides. You can take my place if you like. After yesterday's little revelation, I won't be playing. Seems as if Talmadge didn't think I was very good at the game to begin with.
You're not playing anymore, Evangeline. Neither am I.
Well, that leaves you with only two players, Talmadge. Reba and your new friend in St. George.
Oh, would both of you just stop it?
Yes, I've had enough of this wicked talk.
I thought you were finished with him.
I never said that.
She's right, Beulah. You and I did all the talking last night. Reba just sat in silence, looking pitiful and lost.
Well, that's exactly how I felt. And underneath all your high talk and manners, Evangeline, I believe you feel the same way.
You have the gift of discernment, sister, but I also have my self-respect.
A lot of good that alone will do you.
Well, it's kept me company on many a night these past 14 years, which is more than I can say for Talmadge.
Why didn't you just come right out and say you were coming back to him?
And be eaten alive by the two of you?
Poor child.
Poor child, my eye. You're always trying to get into yourself.
So are you.
But I never resorted to sneaking about. You tell us that you and little Jasher are going for a walk, and lo and behold, we find you pinned.
I have had enough of this.
Oh, stop protesting, Talon. You know you're enjoying this.
Enjoying this?
Having three women fighting over you.
Oh, of course, you're right. I'm having a splendid time. Let's forget about the parade and keep it this all afternoon.
I brought Jasher here to change his clothes for the parade.
Then why aren't you dressing him?
He's big enough to dress himself. I'm following your advice and allowing him a little freedom, sister.
I'm going to the bishop right now. I've had enough of all of this. Either Maharaj, a new wife indeed. I don't believe for one minute the church approves of any of this. And if the bishop will do nothing, then I will go to the state president and on up to the prophet himself. Come on, we're going home.
Which room?
To Aunt Evangeline's.
Are you going to carry those signs?
In the parade today, if I live that long.
But everyone will see them.
If you're going to carry those stupid signs, I'm not going with
Young
you.
Young man, you will do as you're told.
I won't.
Me either. Daddy, tell us you just can't do it.
Your daddy has nothing to do with this. Now come along. I have to speak to the bishop before the parade.
No!
Boys, don't be fresh to your mother.
I can handle my own children, sister. Now the two of you get moving before I pick a switch.
Oh, fine.
Thank you to keep out of this.
No wonder they're always misbehaving when you're always threatening to beat them.
They're boys. They can take it.
Mama, is this all right?
You were married in Mexico, 89.
Oh, that's right, Reba.
No, sisters.
Yes, you were married in August, 89.
How would you know, Bila?
Well, she would know because I sent her to Mexico as my proxy to place your hand in Talmadge's.
Which she never did.
Well, now you've done it, Reba.
What?
They have to know sooner or later, Talmadge. It's all very well for you to keep it a secret when you're traipsing off to St. George all the time, but I have to live here with them.
I was carrying ether. I was ill. That Mexican heat was unbearable.
You've deceived me all these years.
You never asked me about it. You just assumed.
I assumed you were an honest woman.
Don't use that self-righteous tone with me. I consented to the marriage. I obeyed the commandment.
That wasn't enough.
That is the gospel according to you.
Evangeline, don't be angry with her. You more than anyone should be able to sympathize with what she was feeling.
Sympathize? She wanted revenge.
Call it what you like. I wanted you to feel what it was like to give your husband to another woman.
Up until then, I never really felt like Talmadge was my husband because of you. For God's sake, I was 8 months with child.
And I was 6 months alone when I placed your hand in Talmadge's.
Yes, and strong as the mountains around us.
To look strong was my duty to the church. It was not easy, not at all.
I'm sure it wasn't, Evangeline. But if you had seen Beulah those few days before the ceremony, avoiding everyone, even Talmadge, and then the night before the ceremony, the pain started much too soon, and Talmadge was worried. Well, help me explain, Talmadge, you were there.
I was worried about the baby. So I took her to the nearest station, 10 miles away, and put her on the next train for Utah.
And by the time he got back, Apostle Taylor, who was to perform the ceremony, had to leave. The feds were after him, and there was a reward for his capture. But he said that he would perform the ceremony when he came back that way in a month.
I came back to Utah to check on your health, Beulah. And that's when I was arrested for unlawful cohabitation.
Why didn't you tell me then you hadn't married Reba?
I asked him not to. I didn't want to add to your burdens. Besides, I couldn't let you think you'd won that day with your sudden sick spell.
We had no idea that I would spend nearly a year in prison, and when I was finally released, one thing led to another, and we didn't get around to having the ceremony until January of 92.
When Talmadge moved the entire family here to Provo 5 years ago, we decided to tell everyone that Jasher was older, that he was 8.
But why lie about it?
We had to protect the church. We couldn't let anyone know that we had been married after the manifesto.
That wasn't the only reason. We wanted to give this family some peace and quiet after all those years of running and hiding.
Have you had any peace, Reba?
I've hardly slept a night through since I moved here. Do you understand any of this, Jasher? Then listen to me. Your father and I have been very unfair to you. We tried to do what was right, but we made a mistake. We let you think you were 13 when you're not. Your father married me on June 19, 1892 in Arizona, and you were born 9 months later. Your real birthday is March 23, 1893.
So I'm only 10 years old?
That's right.
Does this mean I have to be 12 all over again?
Yes.
Hated being 12.
Well, think of it as a present. A Pioneer Day present from your father and me. We're giving you 3 more years.
It's when I turned 12 that they started calling me puny all the time.
We did not.
It's so.
Just ignore them. You're not puny. You're just as big and strong as any 10-year-old boy should be.
That's right, Jasher.
And think of this. Other boys aren't ordained into the priesthood until they're 12. You were ordained when you were 9. And you were baptized when you were 5. Whereas the other boys had to wait until they were 8. In a way, you're blessed. You're special. Like the prophet Samuel or John the Baptist.
Looking at Jasher, it all seems so obvious. I should have known it wasn't in Talmadge to father a runt.
This can't be.
Well, it is, Beulah, so accept it.
You're not surprised?
Only by the fact that Reba could keep this secret for so long. You're much stronger than I imagined, Reba.
Thank you, Evangeline.
But the deceit that has been practiced in this family.
By all of us, Beulah.
Nothing's really as it seems.
Hardly anything.
Who can you trust? If even the church authorities are hiding things, who can you trust?
Trust whomever or whatever you like. Just beware.
I'm trusting the church and the authorities.
Well, that's no better or worse than trusting anyone else.
Young man, where have you been?
I told you I was going to see the bishop.
All night?
We had a lot to discuss. Afterwards, I just walked the streets thinking until the sun came up.
What do you want?
It wasn't my idea to come back here.
Bishop Kimball told us to come over here.
He said that you and I should discuss our differences privately. Though I suppose privacy in this family is nothing more than a fond, fruitless fancy.
Joseph, you'd be surprised at the number of things we do privately.
Bishop Kimball has assured Brother Fly that I have no intention of ever, ever entering the principle, and he has also assured him that you, Papa, will not try to persuade me to break the laws of the church concerning this matter.
The law of the church?
That's right, Papa. The bishop said that severe action will be taken against any church member entering or advocating new plural marriages.
That's the line we've been feeding the Gentiles for 13 years.
This time it's different.
I'll believe it when I hear it from the prophet himself.
Well, it may come to that, brother, unless you open your eyes and realize that this blatant flaunting of the principle all these years after the manifesto makes all of us in the church look like liars and cheats. Have you ever wondered what the Gentiles next door must think of this family?
The Steinbergs mind their own business.
Ah, but what they must think. 2 women with children living alone together in this house. And then you, coming into the house in the evening and not going out again until morning, all right here in the open. Oh, I wonder what questions the Steinbergs' relatives back east must ask them. So, do Mormon men really have harems? And they could tell them all about it, because right here, not 20 feet from their clothesline, is a living example.
Don't preach to me about caring for the church. All my life I've worked and sacrificed for the church and for our
this
people.
This is getting us nowhere.
I will not sneak around like an adulterer or whoremaster.
Nobody called you any of those things. Now, Papa, I want you to promise Brother Fly that you will not try to persuade me to enter the principal.
If you want to sell your eternal exaltation for a mess of pottage...
Papa, you owe me this much.
He promises, Moroni.
Papa?
You must detest me.
You know that I don't.
I suppose I failed in my duty as a father.
Papa.
All right. I promise.
Then it's settled, Brother Fly. I can marry Zanita.
Yeah.
Now there is just one more little matter.
Oh, yes. This concerns you, Sister Cannon. You and your sister wives. You're a woman. You explain it to them.
Well. The bishop asked us to ask you, and you too, Sister Cannon, if you would reconsider marching in the parade today.
I knew if you marched here carrying those signs, every gossip in Provo would know about your plan.
Maybe Moroni told the bishop. No, I think it was the gossips.
Sister Coles, no doubt.
No, the bishop's counselors.
We're doing nothing wrong in marching. All we're asking is that you tall women become more involved politically.
Don't let them do it, Daddy!
Be quiet, Mahanrai!
Sister Cannon, we know you have the best intentions, but the bishop feels this could hurt the church's image.
How could we possibly do that?
If people see you marching and asking that women become more involved in politics, they'll get the impression that all is not well with your home life. That perhaps Brother Cannon is abusing you. Sisters, we girls know the only women who take to the streets marching and demanding things are those who are unfulfilled in their divinely ordained domestic duties.
If you do this, Sister Cannon, people will get the wrong idea about the principle, that it robs women of their freedom and happiness.
But isn't that why you're opposed to the principle, Joseph?
I'm opposed to it because The church has discontinued the practice, and I am obedient to the church.
Joseph, I'm not one to meddle in the personal affairs of others, but everyone knows you hate the principal because of your mother's suicide.
I have never, ever said that. It is gossip, and you are unkind to throw gossip at me.
Just yesterday you told me that the principal ruined your mother.
I never said those exact words.
But you are opposed to the principal.
I am opposed to anything that might tarnish the church's image.
When I was young, the saints said to hell with our image. We'll obey the law of the Lord whether it offends the world or not.
But how are we to convert the world to our religion if it offends them?
So what are we to do? Water it down until it's so weak it's no longer the same religion? The Lord has called upon us to be a peculiar people. And if you're afraid to be that...
Joseph is just as peculiar as you, Talmadge. We're all peculiar. Peculiar, illogical, and not completely honest, any of us. What about the truth? How we really feel about things?
The time and place for the truth is when we're alone among ourselves. But we cannot hang our dirty garments in public. What would the Gentiles next door think? What about the weak in the church whose fragile testimonies could be crushed if they think our women are feeling unhappy?
I'd say anyone that weak has no business in the church.
Everyone has business being in the church. And it is up to us who know better to strengthen their faith.
So now you want to protect the principle.
I want to forget it is past. But if we are to have reminders of it, and that's just what your family is, the least you can do is present a good image.
In other words, stifle our feelings, avoid the truth.
You aren't doing that right now, Sister Cannon. Keeping your true feelings to yourself, denying them, so as to not undermine the faith that you and your children have built your lives on. You deny doing that.
You have to admit my husband makes good sense, Sister Cannon. I am blessed to have such a good man to take care of me. And I know, despite his little differences with Joseph, that Brother Cannon is also a good man. So why don't the two of you, and the two of you, work out your differences right here in your own home? I don't think any of you really want to march in that parade today. Aren't you just feeling a little frustrated? A little unappreciated at home? Don't you ever feel that way, Helen?
Why, I just suppose that I do. It's in a woman's nature to feel that way every now and then. Joseph can tell you all about my little moods. But he is always so understanding and perceptive. When those times come, I just put those unpleasant thoughts out of my mind and count my many blessings. I think of where I would be without Joseph and the children, and then I swallow my pride, close my eyes to whatever is bothering me, put my shoulder to the wheel, and press on.
You can do that and sleep nights.
Well, I'm not saying that it's easy. Joseph helps. As I said, he puts up with my little moods. And I put up with his. Oh, yes, Joseph has his little moods. And I put up with them. Just as Moroni will have to put up with Zanita's moods, she'll put up with his. That's what marriage is all about, putting up with each other's moods. I do feel sorry for all those Gentile women I hear about who are marching in the streets for their rights. I hear there are even women in the church who feel that way. My heart just bleeds. It just breaks for them. I feel for them with every fiber of my being, because I know how unhappy they are, how dissatisfied they are. But when you are tempted to despair, you just have to force yourself to be satisfied. You just have to gird up your loins and force yourself. These poor unsatisfied women remind me of the Apostle Peter before his conversion on the road to Damascus, when he was so miserable because he was always kicking against the pricks.
That was the Apostle Paul, Helen.
Well, you can see who the gospel scholar in our family is. These women remind me of the Apostle Paul. No righteous woman could ever be satisfied kicking against the pricks, you know.
Maybe I'm just not all that righteous.
Oh, of course you are. Aren't you feeling just a little overworked because of the holiday and all?
Maybe I'd feel better if I marched in that parade. Beulah, are you coming with me?
The bishop would rather that we didn't.
That's what he said.
Then I'm obeying the bishop.
Well, I suppose I'm marching alone then.
What's that smell?
Mahalarai, Maureen, come again.
No, my kitchen!
Oh, no!
My eyes! Lord, get higher!
Mahalarai, what are you doing in there?
Running that stupid sign. You can't march in the parade today. You just can't.
You nearly burnt the house down over that.
We're tired of people talking about our family. Daddy can't control any of his life.
That's it. I am really going to pick a switch now.
Verona, are you all right?
Reba, we put out the fire with water, but your floor's a mess and the ceiling is black.
You and you come here.
Ma'am, Mom's just gonna pick a switch.
No, I want to use my own two hands. Foolish. She's going to have a baby.
At your age.
Reba.
She almost fainted yesterday while hanging out laundry.
Why didn't you tell me?
She didn't want me to.
She wanted me to be the first to find out, and she was afraid of your reaction.
Afraid of me? Her own sister wife? What can I do about it? Say no, Reba. You don't have my permission to be pregnant. Reba, it's me, Beulah. Reba.
What's happened?
You're all right. Just lie still for a few minutes. Why didn't you tell me about this baby?
Oh,
Beulah, I'm sorry. The doctors told me I couldn't have any more children. I don't know how it happened.
Well, you certainly didn't do it by yourself. And what have you got to feel sorry about bringing a new life into this world?
Well, I was afraid you'd disapprove.
Oh, and if I did, what could I do about it? Do you think you can stand up now?
Yes, I think so.
Take it slowly, sister.
Talmadge, you're in the way. Don't you think you've done enough?
Excuse me.
Reba, would you like a blessing?
Oh, yes. Yes, Beulah, I would.
Then let's get you up to that bathtub and we'll wash and anoint you there. Excuse me a minute, Reba. Helen, I want to thank you for what you said earlier. You were right. Sometimes the only way to survive it all is just to close your eyes to whatever is bothering you and press on.
Oh, bless you, sister.
Will you help us with the blessing?
Joseph?
I think we need to be leaving.
Oh, I'm sorry. You were afraid to tell me. I guess I must be an awfully wicked witch sometimes.
Oh, we'll see you later at the parade. Moroni, will you be picnicking with us afterwards?
Yes, Sister Fly.
Oh, how nice. I do hope that Sister Cannon, the third one, Reba, will feel up to coming out this afternoon.
So, you got what you wanted.
Did I?
You're marrying Zanita.
I suppose so.
I expected you to be more happy.
Happy? I feel like I've been married all my life worrying about Mama and all your wives and children.
There's no need for you to worry about them.
Somebody has to when you're running all over creation. When did you find out about Aunt Reba?
Just a while ago.
She wanted to tell you yesterday, but you had other things to worry about.
Well, I can't be in two places at once.
Then the last thing you need to do is marry someone else. Why do you need so many wives?
Gentiles marry out of need. I married out of obedience to God.
You don't really love Aunt Beulah and Aunt Reba.
I love everyone in my family. A man doesn't believe in something, stand up for it, go to prison for it without growing to love it.
But you married them out of obedience?
Yes, of course.
With Mama, it was different, wasn't it? I remember when I was very young, long before Aunt Beulah, the two of you seemed happy. I just took it for granted that you loved each other. Did you, or were the two of you just being obedient?
Obedience brings happiness.
Papa, you're talking theology again.
But it's true!
Did obedience bring you happiness?
I have great joy in my family. I take pride in you and your brothers and sisters.
If you were really happy, you wouldn't want to marry this woman in St. George.
Her name is Jerusha!
Is she pretty?
You wouldn't look at her once, much less twice, were you to see her on the street. But she's very easy to talk to. On Sabbaths after meetings, I often dine with her and her family. And during the week, if I finished on the plantation early and it's still light, I'd ride over to her house. I'd sit on the porch, watch the sunset, and talk. It's very pleasant, very restful. She has a son your age. I meant to tell you yesterday that he was born on December 3rd, 1879, just 2 days before you. Isn't that a coincidence? He's unmarried also, but then again, he's not as nice looking as you.
Papa, I am not interested. I wouldn't take $1 million for any of my brothers and sisters, but I wouldn't give you a plug nickel for another one, so you just leave him out of this. I want you to apologize to Mama.
For what?
Do all men go blind when they grow older? You have hurt Mama deeply. Maybe you only married her out of obedience. I don't know. I don't want to know. But she married you out of love because she needed you.
Evangeline is the most self-reliant person I've ever met.
She wants you to love her.
I have worked all my life to provide for her, never once complaining. I've given her everything she needs, everything she's asked for, much more than I've given the other two.
It can't be this hopeless. It just can't be.
I've never made any demands on her because I knew her hands were filled with you children.
But the woman you really love is in St. George?
Moroni, someday when you're older,
finish that sentence if you're implying that one day I'll ever be anything like you. Right now, I never want that to happen.
You do despise me.
I wish I did. I'd be less confused. I don't. The bishop said you won't be allowed to marry this lady.
There's a storm brewing in Washington over whether a Mormon can be a senator if the church allows its members to break polygamy laws.
The church will never completely renounce the principle, certainly not for political power.
They already have. You only have three wives, Papa. One of them is my mother, and you owe her an apology whether you believe it or not.
Cabbage?
There she is, Papa. Papa, please. The way I remember the two of you being when I was a child, that wasn't just my imagination, was it?
Cabbage!
All right, Moroni.
How's Aunt Reba?
Feeling much better. Talmadge, you're wanted on the telephone. I think it's the bishop.
What does he want?
Your future father-in-law is a very discerning man. What he said about denying one's true feelings regarding the principle, that was very discerning. It galls me to say that because I detest the way he talks down to Helen. But then again, she doesn't seem to mind. Maybe I'd be happier if I were as simple-minded as she.
I think we'd all be happier in this family if we weren't so set in our ways. I know how Papa can be, but if you could just... I mean, if we could all just...
What? Give in a little more?
No, no, not exactly.
Because that's all I've been doing all these years. I wanted it all to work. I did, so desperately.
I know you did, Mama. I'm not criticizing, really. You've always been the strong one. Why, when he married Aunt Beulah, you didn't speak for a week. They went off together and you said nothing.
Do you really think I could have stopped him from marrying her?
No, but at least you would have known it bothered you. It bothered me. When I was 9, I started having this nightmare. We were all in heaven, the celestial kingdom. And there on a throne was Papa, just like a god. And he was surrounded by all these beautiful goddess wives. But you and I were separated from him somehow. He and all his goddess wives were loving and adoring, and I hated them. And I screamed out to you, Mama, do something so we won't lose him. Tell him that you love him.
You don't think I loved your papa?
I know you do.
It's because I loved him that I said nothing. Your papa loves the church, first and foremost. And as much as we hate to admit that, that's the way it is. If I have, you know, just objected or voiced my doubts, that would have been the end of it. Oh, my heart was full of hell when he took Beulah. But I fought to appear strong, indifferent to her, and devoted to the church.
But Papa thinks you're indifferent to him. The two of you are separated, but I'm both of you. I can't choose sides. Anyway, it's all over now. The church says polygamy is gone, never to be brought back again.
Then what was all the sacrifice, all the heartache for? If something so important can change, maybe none of it is true.
Of course the church is true.
Then where is my place in it now? Where do I belong? Maybe on display in some Gentile museum back east. A concubine in a Mormon harem circa 1903.
Well, I'm glad to see you've gotten your sense of humor back.
But I'm sealed into the church. It's the only place I could ever hope to be understood or respected, or even pitied. You and your brothers and sisters are the sealing agents, not priesthoods, oaths, and covenants. And through you, I'm sealed to your papa. And through him, to the church. Maybe that was the plan all along. The prophets knew that the principle was the only way to knot us all together in the church so that we'd never leave.
Now, Mama, stop that.
Oh, how clever they were. How clever and very cruel.
Mama, you don't mean that. Things will be different now. I know that. I'm gonna marry Zanita and things will be different, better from here on. You're just feeling a little tired and overworked because of the holiday, just like Sister Fly said.
Why, Sister Fly?
You'll feel better after the parade and picnic. We all will. I'll go see if I can help Aunt Beulah get the boys ready for the parade.
Why the fallen countenance?
Well, they did it. The church has finally sold out to the Gentiles. The bishop just told me that if I go through with marrying Jerusha, that she and I and whoever performs the ceremony could be excommunicated. He really told me that over the telephone, a damn contraption.
Ah, oh, poor lamb. Lost your one true love,
I thought the news would make you happy.
You were right.
You take such pleasure in my disappointment, don't you?
After all these years, do you really think I could take pleasure in your pain?
I'm hurting and you're smiling.
I'm hurting and smiling also. It's how I register pain.
I don't know why an older woman like Jerusha should threaten you. Beulah was only 22 when I married her. It may have bothered you, but...
More than you'll ever know.
But you never said a word. Nor did you have that smile on your face.
I was younger then. I hadn't learned to glow when I hurt.
You didn't smile. You didn't smile when I married Reba, and she was only 18.
Wrong. She was 21. And I thought after Beulah, I could accept anything.
Then why couldn't you accept Jerusha?
I was wrong.
But Jerusha is an older woman. While Reba and Beulah were only girls.
I wouldn't let their youth threaten me.
So if Jerusha were 16, you'd accept the marriage?
Certainly not. And she'd be forgotten like all other pretty young girls that men your age look at. But you won't forget this Jerusha, will you? Even though the church won't allow you to marry her, she'll still occupy a place in your heart. The place I occupied, or thought I occupied until yesterday.
About that, I'm sorry for what I said.
Did Moroni put you up to apologizing?
Of course not. I am truly sorry I said all that.
Well, don't you remember? It's what you didn't say that was wounding.
Then I'm sorry for what I didn't say.
Well, don't apologize if you were being honest.
You deserve better from me.
I deserve the truth from you. Now, if it hurts you to speak it or me to hear it, then so be it. But after all these years together, we need to know exactly where we stand in relation to each other. So come on, Talmadge, put your shoulder to the wheel and just tell me outright.
Oh, Evangeline, I'm so tired.
That's no answer.
I look back, and all I see is a rush and whirl of sneaking about, hiding from the law, praying for deliverance, trying to maintain a business and households, trying to treat wives and children equally so that no one gets their feelings hurt. I'm exhausted. Why did we ever start this life of ours in the first place?
I don't know why you married me. It was a commandment, and everyone else our age was doing it. If nothing else, you were an obedient soul. And there were the cravings of the flesh. I know on my part there were. All these things may have influenced you. The time, the place, the ceremony. Who knows why anyone does it? I thought I married you for only one reason.
You loved me.
Oh, so you were there afterward.
You were overwhelming. You were so strong, and I was attracted to you, but at the same time, you made me feel like a helpless puppy or a child.
I never really had you, did I, Talmadge?
We had passion in the beginning.
Well, the children in time killed that.
We've had an adventurous life, nothing dull about it. We've had some happy times.
Yes, we have some. But we never really had each other, did we?
I suppose not.
Will we ever?
Not in this life.
Ouch.
Who knows? Come the morning of the first resurrection, when we're both restored to our prime, I'll look at you and feel the old passion again.
Oh, dear God. If that's the best we can hope for, just leave me moldering.
You wanted the truth.
I wanted the lie. But the truth is what I deserve. All in all, it's the best thing for me. Thank you.
for finally giving it to me.
Is there anything else I can say?
No, Talmadge. This isn't a theological debate. This is life as it really is, and it can be restructured or rephrased to make it less offensive, or to make it go down like mother's milk. We'll just have to digest it for the meat that it is.
Evangeline, what will you do? Where will you go?
To the house. The children are waiting for me to take them to the parade. Where in the world did you think I was going? Oh, Talmadge, you didn't think I was leaving, did you? Just because of our problems? There are more people in this family than you and I. They're the children, Beulah and Reba, this new baby.
The way you looked, I thought you were going away.
Oh, no, Talmadge. You won't get rid of me that easily. We were married for time and all eternity, remember? And in that ceremony, I was taught that you were to be my husband and Lord. Well, draw near, dear Lord. I have a confession for your ears only. Now, you mark it well, because I'll not repeat it. My dear Talmadge, you are not now, nor will you ever be, a god. Nor will I or anyone else on this sweet earth. We just don't have the makings for it. We've got our hands full just trying to get along as human beings. And Christ knows we've made an awful mess of that.
But the church teaches, as man now is, God once was. As God now is, man may become.
I know all that. I just don't believe it. Not one word, not one jot or tittle.
You don't mean that.
But I do.
I don't believe you.
You have your free agency.
You're trying to goad me by playing the apostate.
I have never been more sincere in my life.
I know the church is true.
Well, you just go right on knowing that. I know otherwise.
What do you know?
I know that this business of life is much more simple than you and the church make it out to be. I know that I have children who need me, and I need them.
You brought those children into my family.
Well, they're more mine than yours. And I will not let you or the church or my own foolhardy attempts to make your gospel work come between me and them any longer.
Oh my God, you are an apostate.
Yes, I am. Tell Moroni or anyone else and I'll feign ignorance. Expose me and I'll deny it.
Your words will expose you.
Oh no, dearest heart. The words are for you only. And just this once. I'll be the most dangerous and clever of apostates. I'll never utter a testimony of anything again, but I'll be at every church meeting, listening and smiling. How could I do otherwise? It's all I've ever known. And I lavish on our children and your wives and everyone else all the love and understanding that until now, I reserved for you and the church. And that love will become more important to them than all your priesthood's doctrines and power, because it'll be free. No conditions attached. My children will know that I love them, regardless of their standing with the church or with your God. That's all I have to offer. All I've ever had. It wasn't enough for you. Too easily attained, I suppose, or too simple for your patriarchal tastes. But it will be more than enough for them. I'll win all their hearts in the end, and I'll never have to utter a word. Oh, there she is! Oh, your color's looking good, Reba. Are you sure you feel up to going out in the heat?
Oh, after that beautiful blessing you and Beulah gave me, I feel up to anything. You should have heard it, Talmadge.
Well, you certainly look better. fresher, doesn't she, Beulah?
That's the word I'd use, fresher.
I feel refreshed myself.
You look it. Has something happened?
I've just seen the day for what it is, and I feel clean all over.
What?
Oh, nothing. I just feel good. This is going to be a really nice pioneer day. Now, we need to stop at the big house and get the other children and the picnic baskets we packed this morning.
Do we get to spend the night at your house again tonight, Aunt Evangeline?
I think we'll stay here from now on.
Mama, we like the big house.
Let them spend the night anyway, Beulah. And wouldn't you like a night off? Besides, I know how stuffy this little house can be on a summer night when everyone is at home. And with Reba's baby coming, you won't be able to stay in this little place much longer. Townage, when did you say you were building these ladies each their own house?
What? Are you really going to build me a house, Townage?
Well, you deserve to have each your own house, don't they, Moroni?
Ma'am? Yes, ma'am. Yes, Papa, Reba and Buell each need their own house.
You tell him, son, he'll listen to you. Don't you let him tell you he can't fit it into the budget, because the plantation in St. George is doing fine this year.
Yes, Mama.
Oh, okay. Shall we go? Well, come along, Talmadge. Don't just sit there like a helpless puppy or a child.
Come on, Talmadge. Get your banner.
Can I carry it to the parade for you, Daddy?
I don't feel like marching today after all.
Would you like me to carry it for you into the parade, Papa? I'd be glad to if you like.
Thank you, son. But there's no need to bother anymore.
Yes, it's been very hot today. And now that we're on better terms with the flies, maybe they'd like to picnic with us after the parade.
Oh, wouldn't that be special? Both families together.
Oh, yes, together.